By golly, it's amazing. It sounds like something you'd hear on the radio.
Presenting the transcription feature.
The Lucky Strike program starring Jack Benny with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Rochester, Dennis Day, and yours truly, Don Wilson.
It's 8:30 New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the expert.
From Hollywood, it's time now for...
Johnny Dollar.
Kraft presents The Great Gildersleeve. Yeah.
And now meet Dick Calmer as Boston Blackie.
It's the Phil Harris Alice Faye Show, presented transcribed by the makers of Rexall drug products.
And now it's time to meet the men from the ministry.
The Armed Forces Radio and Television Service presents the Bob Hope Show with Les Brown and his band of renown. And yours truly, Bill Goodwin. And now here he is, Bob Hope.
Greetings. I'm Kevin Lauderdale.
For the 4th of July, we're going to present two Independence Day-themed episodes of classic old-time radio shows. First the drama, then the comedy. We'll start off with Family Theater, which was a drama anthology show that ran on the Mutual Network from February of 1947 to September of 1957. It was produced and sponsored, in essence, since it had no ads, by Family Theater Productions, the entertainment branch of the Family Rosary Crusade, a campaign founded by Catholic priest Patrick Peyton. If you've ever heard the phrase, the family that prays together stays together, that's where this came from. Over those more than 10 years, 540 episodes were produced, all of it designed to be family-friendly. The show was a mix of original stories and adaptations of literary classics, usually starring big names from Hollywood. This particular story is a dramatization of a particular moment in history, the writing of the Declaration of Independence. It's narrated by Loretta Young, who you may know from the 1947 classic film The Bishop's Wife, or the long-running The Loretta Young Show, and stars Robert Stack of TV's The Untouchables and later Unsolved Mysteries as Thomas Jefferson. And if you're a fan of the musical 1776, pay attention to what's the same in this adaptation and what's different. From July 1st, 1953, Family Theater, The Longest Hour.
Family Theater presents Loretta Young, Robert Stack, and Gene Lockhart. From Hollywood, the Mutual Network, in cooperation with Family Theater, presents The Longest Hour, starring Robert Stack and Gene Lockhart. To introduce the drama, here is your hostess, Loretta Young.
Thank you. Thank you, Tony Lafrano. Family Theater's only purpose is to bring to everyone's attention a practice that must become an important part of our lives if we are to win peace for ourselves, peace for our families, and peace for the world. Family Theater urges you to pray. Pray together as a family. And now, to our transcribed drama, The Longest Hour, starring Gene Lockhart as Adam and Robert Stack as Jefferson. It is the night of July 1st, 1776. In a small, stuffy anteroom of the Pennsylvania State House at Philadelphia, five weary men working by candlelight are gathered about a writing desk littered with crumpled sheets of paper. They're tired. Their nerves are on edge. Their patience at the breaking point.
Gentlemen, let's be realistic about this. We are failing in our task.
Come now, Adams. We are having difficulties, to be sure, but they are not insuperable.
Mr. Franklin, I admire your skill as a diplomat, but this is a time for brutal truth. not diplomacy.
And what is the brutal truth, Mr. Adams?
That this committee, which was formed to draft a declaration of independence, is not capable of doing so. I declared from the beginning, Jefferson, that such a document, if it's to be written at all, must be the product of a single intelligence. And now I'm being proved right.
I find small satisfaction in your being right, Mr. Adams. Right or wrong, we must have a declaration ready when the convention continues in the morning.
And more than that, Sherman, it must be one upon which we five will stand or fall.
You've been hopping on that ever since the committee convened, Livingston. Don't you think it can be done?
Frankly, I don't. We five were not chosen by accident. Our backgrounds differ as well as our views.
You needn't keep reminding me that you are an aristocrat.
Now, Roger.
And you, Sherman, needn't take the position that a man must have grime under his nails to be a patriot.
Gentlemen, this is a poor moment for bickering.
Call it bickering if you will, Mr. Franklin. The fact stands. No two of this committee are in agreement, much less all five.
John, whatever purpose lay behind the choice of committee members, it remains that if the declaration is longer delayed, the convention will never adopt it. This is the hour, the last hour.
Well, then, what has been done? You, Mr. Jefferson, for a man so popular with the crowd, you've lapsed into an unseemly silence.
I've been trying on paper to frame a beginning to this, Mr. Adams. The actual language of the declaration.
Well.
It's just a start. But how does this sound? When, in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for a people to advance from that subordination in which they have hitherto remained...
No, it's too windy, Jefferson. The opening's all right, but after that you're
going to... No, the last part sounds negative, Tom, as if we're apologizing. And I don't care for the word subordination.
Read it again, Tom. Slowly.
When, in the course of human events... It becomes necessary for a people to advance from that...
That's the word I balk at. Advance. It's not strong enough. I think that's where it goes off. We're doing more than advancing. We're cutting ourselves off from the crown.
All right. Instead of advance, let's try sever.
That's better.
Tom?
Yes, Mr. Franklin.
Sever is undoubtedly the word to describe the precise action that we're taking, but... I think for our part, the language should indicate a more natural progression to freedom. Something that's our due.
How about dissolve?
Dissolve? Much better. Try going on from there.
In the course of human events, it becomes necessary for a people to dissolve the bands which have connected them with another.
Try making a people one people.
For one people to dissolve the bands which have connected them with another...
No. It still sounds negative.
Just a minute, Roger. Just a minute.
All right.
How's this? Which have connected them with another. And to assume among the powers of the earth the equal and independent station...
Yeah, now, that phrase.
Please,
right,
Mr.
There.
Adams. Station to which the laws of nature... And nature's God entitled them.
Better. It tells what we're after.
I don't like equal and independent. The language is misleading.
Mr. Adams, if we haggle over every word, this will never be finished.
You haggled on a point of grammar a moment ago, Sherman. The phrase equal and independent, I say, is misleading.
Is it the word equal which disturbs you, Mr. Adams?
It is not. Retain equal, Mr. Jefferson. But change independent... To separate.
We are proclaiming our independence, are we not?
Precisely. And the proclamation is implicit in the document. I want to make clear that the individual sovereignty of each colony is assured.
Good heavens, Mr. Adams, are we to fight the British colony by colony, or are we forming a union?
A union. A union of sovereign states, yes.
Mr. Adams, I feel the word independent should appear prominently in the declaration.
I've no wish that it shall not, Livingston, but I can promise you that unless the separate character of each colony is guaranteed in writing, Massachusetts will not be signatory to this agreement.
Tom, since it is our intention to guarantee such sovereignty to the colonies, might this not be an appropriate place to say so?
But Mr. Franklin,
the question, after all, is something we can settle amongst ourselves. Our ringing declaration of our freedom is what we wish to have sound loudest in the ears of King George.
Very well, Mr. Franklin. to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and nature's God entitle them.
And so it went, phrase after phrase, word after word. The candles burnt low and fluttered out. And one or another of the five men in the anteroom replaced them and continued to pace the floor, wrestling with the language of a document that none of them dared hope had any claim to permanence, much less to immortality. John Adams, stiff and brusque in his too warm velvet and watered silk. Franklin, bald and aging, peering over the rimless spectacles he invented. Livingston, the impeccable aristocrat. Sherman, the zealot in homespun. And Thomas Jefferson, lean and ungainly, bent over the table, scratching out the alphabet of freedom with a quill pen.
A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the change.
Ah, there again, Jefferson. I believe the word should be separation.
Mr. Adams, what is this fatal fascination that things separate have for you?
It is not a matter of fascination, but of construction.
Every word, haggle, haggle. There's no will to finish this task.
I don't know, but I prefer separation in this case.
At the risk of appearing undiplomatic, I'll stand with Jefferson. Change. We are making a change. It conveys the sense of what we are doing.
I say there's no will to finish this. Every word, every comma, haggling.
Come in.
Gentlemen.
What is it, Mr. Morris?
I think you should know that some of the convention members are caucusing unofficially.
What? Caucusing? For what purpose?
There is talk of adjourning the convention permanently.
Adjourning the convention? What is it?
I say to you, it's criminal nonsense to think of adjournment now.
Nevertheless, Mr. Adams, it's in the wind. Some say the British power is too great for us, that we can never expect any real help from France.
We've been fighting the British for the past 14 months. If their power is so great, why haven't they crushed us?
I'm only repeating the rumors, Mr. Jefferson.
Gentlemen, we must at least use up the time left to us. If at the end of the hour we are not united in support of a document that can be taken before the convention with faith and fire, then I too will admit the effort is hopeless.
Time. It was a fight now against time and faint-heartedness, against the mutterings of sunshine patriots and men of little faith. As the minutes went by, Jefferson scratched furiously at the document before him, the other members nodding as they read over his shoulder, now and then offering a suggestion or making a comment. Almost unnoticed, a gray light crept slowly into the room as the dawn quietly, gradually pushed back the shades of night.
We hold these truths to be sacred and undeniable.
Tom, I suggest we change sacred and undeniable to self-evident.
Self-evident.
I see little difference or improvement in the change, Mr. Franklin.
It's a tactical point, John. If we say self-evident, we put the convention in the position of not being sure what to attack.
I'll accept that. Mr. Adams?
Very well. Anyway.
We hold these truths to be self-evident. That all men are created free and equal.
No, not created. Born free and equal.
On the contrary, Mr. Adams, we are created, and our equality is God-given by that act of creation. If men are merely born, they have no one to pray to. But if they are created, then it is by a divine agency, by God. And to him they may turn in time of trouble or to give thanks.
Very well. Very well, Mr. Jefferson. Continue.
That all men are created free and equal, and that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. That among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Haggle, haggle, haggle. We'll never finish this on time.
Gentlemen, we're almost finished. Now let's try to hold on to our tempers a little longer.
Well, Mr. Adams, such as it is, it's finished.
Yes. Not a bad document, Jefferson. Not bad at all.
Now, if we can get it through the convention...
We'll never know until we try, Mr. Livingston. So, shall we enter the arena, gentlemen?
What's your opinion, Mr. Franklin?
Well, at least they sat quietly while it was being read to them.
I think we can expect some trouble before the voting.
The aristocrats don't like it much.
I'm an aristocrat, Sherman, and I helped write it.
Mr. Chairman! Mr. Chairman!
It's starting. Yeah. The faint hearts, I knew it.
The chair recognizes General Schuyler of New York. Mr. Chairman, as a representative of my sovereign state, I cannot vote on a matter of such debatable import without months to consider. The chair recognizes Mr. Jefferson of Virginia.
Mr. Chairman, we are a year and 2 months from Lexington and Concord. All that time, Americans have been fighting and dying for independence, and the whole world knows it. And still we have not, as a people, declared our independence to the world. There are no more months left us in which to consider the matter. We must act now or never.
Mr. Chairman!
The chair recognizes Mr. Franklin from Pennsylvania.
Mr. Chairman, it is not the purpose of this committee to force upon an unwilling convention a document which does not, in every particular, reflect the combined sentiment of this body. Compromise is of the essence of true self-government, and we are all willing to compromise, but not upon principle. And it is the principle of independence which is here at stake. Gentlemen, the hour is late. We had better agree we will all hang together, or we are mortally bound to be hanged separately.
The chair recognizes Mr. Lee of Virginia.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the convention assemble adopt the following resolution: that these United Colonies are right and ought to be free and independent states.
We're in for a fight, Mr. Franklin.
I'm not so sure. There may be a way around this.
Let's press for a vote. Mr. Lee's resolution constitutes the heart of the declaration.
But Livingston, they aren't ready to accept the draft declaration as it stands.
Exactly.
I think what Mr. Livingston means is that if we can force a vote on the Lee resolution and the convention accepts it, the declaration will follow as a matter of course.
It won't. They'll change it. They'll cut it to pieces.
We have to risk that, Tom.
I say Mr. Adams is right. Vote on the Lee resolution first. It's our only chance.
And as for changing the draft, heavens, man, we aren't infallible.
I don't claim we are, Mr. Adams.
Gentlemen, let's address ourselves to the business at hand.
Mr. Franklin, the chairman's trying to catch your eye.
I know. He's been estimating the pros and cons. I think Harrison's with us.
Yes, it looks as if he wanted a sign from you, Mr. Franklin.
Yes, well, are we all agreed? Shall we force a vote now, John?
I think I can promise you the Massachusetts delegation.
I've already spoken to Wellcott and Huntington in the Connecticut delegation. We can count on them.
I'm certain of Virginia. What about your own state, Mr. Franklin?
I believe Pennsylvania will do the right thing.
Well, then I say let's call for a vote.
Yes, yeah,
very well, gentlemen. Roger, you have a powerful fist. Start pounding it on that desk, would you?
All right.
Mr. Chairman.
The chair recognizes Mr. Franklin of Pennsylvania.
Mr. Chairman, I second the resolution just put before the convention by Mr. Lee of Virginia and move that at this time a vote be taken on its passage by the Congress.
The chair rules in the affirmative on the motion of the member of the Pennsylvania delegation.
Hear,
hear. The vote will be taken at this time on the resolution submitted to the convention by Mr. Lee of Virginia. We will call the roll of the colonies. Connecticut, 4 votes.
Connecticut cast its 4 votes.
Yeah!
In favor of the resolution.
Yeah!
Jonathan.
Yeah.
Jonathan, have you seen the paper this morning?
I have. The British have won another battle in New York. They'll be here in Philadelphia before you know it.
Oh, no, no, I don't mean that. Here, look, this little item on the back page. Read it.
This day, the Continental Congress declared the United Colonies free and independent states. Is that all there is to it?
Don't you know what it means, Jonathan?
Mm-hmm.
We're free. We've cut ourselves loose from England.
But shouldn't there be more?
What else is needed, Jonathan? We're free. Free men and women, Jonathan. The Congress has said so.
Well, I can't believe it. Maria, I can't believe it.
I heard Mr. Jefferson's to read the declaration in the courtyard of the State House this afternoon, and that anyone can come who wants.
Well, then why are you standing there? Get your bonnet, wife. Get your bonnet.
We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do in the name and by the authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states they have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
Mr. Adams, I should say young Jefferson reads almost as well as he writes.
Yes, indeed. There's a lot to learn, but I believe he'll learn it.
Mr. Franklin, listen to that crowd. They're for it. The Declaration says what they want it to say.
Yes, Tom, I think it does.
Do you feel the people are with us now, Mr. Adams?
Indeed, I do. Yes. Well, the greatest question that was ever debated in America has been decided. And a greater, perhaps, will never be decided, and never was, among free men.
There's still a long fight ahead of us.
I'm well aware of the blood and toil and treasure it will cost us to maintain the Declaration. And yet, through all the gloom, I can see the rays of ravishing light and glory.
I think that it will be a memorable day.
Perhaps the most memorable in the history of America. I believe it will be solemnized by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival.
It deserves to be celebrated with every kind of pomp and parade, with shows, games, sports, guns, bells, bonfires, from one end of this continent to the other.
And from this day forward, forevermore.
Yes. But above all, it should be, it must be, forever commemorated as our day of deliverance, commemorated by solemn acts of devotion to God Almighty.
And now, here is your hostess, Miss Loretta Young.
Thank you, Tony Lafrano. The family that prays together stays together.
More things are wrought by prayer than this world dreams of. From Hollywood, Family Theater has brought you The Longest Hour, starring Robert Stack and Gene Lockhart. Loretta Young was your hostess. Others in our cast were Norman Field, Fred Shields, John Stevenson, Pat McGeehan, Billy Baucom, Abigail Bonney, and Dave Young. The script was written by John T. Kelly, from an original story by Robert Hardy Andrews, with music composed and conducted by Harry Zimmerman, and was directed and transcribed for Family Theater by Joseph F. Mansfield. This series of Family Theater broadcasts is made possible by the thousands of you who feel the need for this type of program, by the Mutual Network, which has responded to this need, and by the hundreds of stars of stage, screen, and radio who give so unselfishly of their time and talent to appear on our Family Theater stage. To them and to you, our humble thanks. This is Tony Lafrano expressing the wish of Family Theater that the blessing of God may be upon you and your home.
Now the comedy. Here's an episode of Our Miss Brooks, in which our intrepid heroine plans to meet her boyfriend in the countryside for the 4th of July weekend. From July 3rd, 1949, Our Miss Brooks, July 4th trip to Eagle Springs, a.k.a. Conklin's blood pressure.
Palm Olive Soap, your beauty hope, and Luster Cream Shampoo for soft, glamorous, caressable hair bring you Our Miss Brooks, starring Eve Arden. When the 4th of July weekend arrived at Madison High Summer School, it was welcomed most enthusiastically by Our Miss Brooks, who teaches English there.
I don't know why I looked forward to such a brief holiday with such keen anticipation. I like my work, and I'm very fond of my pupils. Then there's the school principal, Mr. Osgood Conklin. Well, what do you know? I just found out why I look forward to such a brief holiday with such keen anticipation. Mr. Conklin and I never have been what the scientists call chemical affinities. But last week, we really reached the ultimate in mutual harassment. I would hesitate to describe Mr. Conklin's temper as volcanic, but by last Thursday, I would swear I saw a thin trickle of lava flowing out of his ears. I was telling my landlady, Mrs. Davis, about it Friday morning at breakfast. He hasn't been this irritable since last month when I broke his new glasses.
My goodness, Connie, how did you do that?
It was an accident, Mrs. Davis. They broke when we both bent down at the same time.
You both bent down?
Yes, to pick up a hammer I had dropped on his foot.
Osgood is certainly hard to get along with. Connie, did you say you wanted tea or coffee this morning?
I said I wanted milk, Mrs. Davis.
Oh, of course you did. I'm getting so absent-minded lately. Almost as bad as my sister Angela.
How is Angela, Mrs. Davis?
Angela?
Your sister.
Oh. She's terribly absent-minded, poor dear. Why, the other morning, do you know what she did?
No, what?
She found herself with one foot in the bathtub and one foot out of the bathtub.
Well, there's nothing absent-minded about that. It happens to most of us, sooner or later.
But Angela couldn't remember whether she was just getting into the tub. Or whether she was just getting out.
Well, that is a dilemma. What did she do?
She let the water out and took a shower. Now, I'd better get you that hot chocolate you wanted.
It's milk, Mrs. Davis, and it's right here on the table. Can I pour some for you?
Oh, no, thanks, Connie. I never drink milk in the morning. It keeps me up all day.
Maybe we should have gone on talking about Mr. Conklin.
Say, that reminds me, Connie. How's Mr. Conklin been treating you lately?
You should have seen him yesterday when I stopped in at his office to get my check.
Was he very disagreeable, Connie?
Not at first. That's what's so confusing. When I sat down to sign for the check, he was extremely civil to me, almost courteous. And then in a few seconds, boom, his whole attitude changed.
But why?
That's what I'd like to know. You think I spilled that bottle of ink on his coat purposely?
Oh, Connie. Not a bottle of ink.
I couldn't help it, Mrs. Davis, and I tried my best to get out the spots.
With what?
With spot remover, of course. Or at least I thought it was spot remover. It isn't my fault that Mr. Conklin keeps ammonia in his desk, is it?
Ammonia? But, Connie, ammonia will just burn right through the cloth.
Please, Mrs. Davis, you sound just like Mr. Conklin. But I won't be running into him for the next few days, thank goodness. I'm going away for the July 4th weekend.
But Connie, can you afford to go away?
On my salary, I can't afford to stay home. But I've made up my mind to do it if I have to go without lunch for a week. And guess where I'm going, Mrs. Davis?
Where?
To Eagle Springs. And guess what bashful scientist is going to get the surprise of his life because he's going there, too, and doesn't know I'm coming?
It's not Mr. Boynton.
It ain't Al Einstein. Now, if you'll excuse me, Mrs. Davis, I'll get ready for school. Walter Denton should be picking me up pretty soon.
Oh, I'm sorry, Connie, but there's something I forgot to tell you. Walter called while you were in the shower and said he can't pick you up this morning.
Oh, great. And my car won't budge.
What's the matter with it, Connie?
I don't know exactly. Last time I went out to the garage to look at it, it was lying on its side, panting.
Walter said he hoped you'd understand, but he had to drive Mr. Conklin to the doctor's this morning.
The doctor's? Why, that's a shame. I wonder what's wrong with poor Mr. Conklin.
Well, Osgood, I can't seem to find anything radically wrong with your physical condition, outside of a slightly elevated blood pressure, that is.
What is my blood pressure, Dr. Haney?
Oh, nothing to worry about, Osgood. Around 180, I'd say. Of course, if it gets to 200, I'd advise you to sell.
If there's one thing I've always wanted, it's a comical physician. Now tell me, Doctor, what's wrong with me?
Well, I can't discover any physical symptoms, Osgood, but there's no doubt about it. Something seems to be troubling you mentally. Now, what is it?
It isn't a what, it's a who. And what a who. Even when we're not together, I can still see her face before me.
But Osgood, who is this woman?
It's Miss Brooks, Doctor. She teaches English at Madison.
It seems to me, Osgood, if Miss Brooks grates on your nerves so much, you shouldn't let her cross your path. Avoid contact with her whenever possible. As a matter of fact, I recommend that you leave town for a few days.
That's it. I'll do it. I'll go away for the 4th of July weekend. But where?
Oh, it doesn't matter where. Do your world of good to get away for a few days. Say, now, maybe I can help you.
You?
Why, sure. I know the squaw in charge of reservations on the chief. Oh,
It will be good to get away.
Miss Brooks, you're just the person I wanted to see.
Good morning, Harriet. What can I do for you?
It's Daddy, Miss Brooks. I'm real worried about him. Last night he cried out in his sleep several times. Mother had to keep waking him up, and once in his sleep he screamed out your name.
My name?
Yes. That's when Mother had to tie him to the bed.
I think I can explain your father's nocturnal penchant for screaming my name, Harriet. We've spent the better part of this week exchanging unpleasantries.
Then Daddy did have words with you?
Harriet, your daddy had words that I wouldn't repeat in front of a sailor.
He was extremely nervous this morning when Walter Denton drove him to the doctor's.
Well, I hope his doctor has a good doctor. Now, if you'll excuse me, Harriet, I'll run along to class.
Just a minute, Miss Brooks. Here's Daddy now.
Oh, good morning, Harriet. Well, the doctor says there's nothing wrong with me physically at all.
I knew it. You look better already.
Thank you, my dear.
Good morning, Mr. Conklin. He just took a turn for the worse.
Good morning, Miss Brooks. So far, I'd better get into my office now. I'll see you later, Harry.
All right, Daddy. But what's the umbrella for?
It looked like rain when I left for the doctor's. Oh, by the way, it's a rather sturdy umbrella, Miss Brooks. Care to whack me over the head with it to start off the day?
Oh, of course not, Mr. Conklin.
You're sure now?
I'll take a rain check. I mean, I'm positive. Oh, hold still a minute, Mr. Conklin. There's a thread hanging from the lapel of your coat. I'll pull it out for you.
You needn't bother.
It's no bother. I'll pull it out in just a second. There, that does it. No, there seems to be more. Hold still, please.
I'm waiting, Miss Brooks.
I'm pulling, Mr. Conklin.
His lapel looks all right, Miss Brooks.
Oh, I'm getting it now. This is a new suit, Mr. Conklin?
Yes. Yes, it is. No doubt you remember my old suit, Miss Brooks. The one The one with the ink spots.
Ink spots? How in the world did you get... Oh, that one.
Yes, that one. I thought you'd like to know that I cleaned Walter Denton's windshield with it this morning.
Well, it certainly needed it. I mean, I'm sorry about your suit, Mr. Conklin, but... Say, this is funny. There doesn't seem to be any end to this thread.
So I see. Miss Brooks, would you be good enough to give me the ball of thread you're holding in your hand? I'll have another lapel sewn on.
Oh, forgive me, Mr. Conklin. I didn't realize...
My brand new suit. Two pairs of pants and one lapel. Let me in that office immediately, huh? Step aside, Harry.
But, Daddy... Daddy seems quite annoyed at you this morning, doesn't he, Miss Brooks?
I think so. In fact, there's an old Eskimo saying that describes his feelings toward me perfectly. It goes, Pulikamu Conakrio Exro.
What does that mean?
Baby, it's cold outside.
Miss Brooks, starring Eve Arden, will continue in just a moment. But first, here is Vern Smith.
Here's wonderful news, ladies. Wonderful, wonderful news. Now there's something thrillingly new in Palmolive Soap's famous beauty lather. Yes, something thrillingly new. Palmolive's famous beauty lather now brings you new fragrance, new charm, new allure.
Millions of women will prefer beauty lather Palmolive over all other leading toilet soaps the minute they try it. For Palmolive Soap's famous beauty lather... now has a new, clean, flower-fresh fragrance for new allure, new charm.
So, ladies, forget all other beauty care and use Palmolive soap the way doctors advised for a lovelier complexion. Just stop improper cleansing and instead wash your face with Palmolive soap three times a day, massaging Palmolive's wonderful beauty lather onto your skin for 60 seconds each time to get its full beautifying effect. Then rinse. That's all. All types of skin, young, older, oily, respond to it quickly. Don't wait another day to try Palmolive's beauty lather. You'll be thrilled by its new fragrance, new charm, new allure. Thrilled again by the fresher, brighter complexion doctors prove may soon be yours.
For new loveliness all over, use big bath-size Palmolive in tub or shower.
Well, I had no further encounters with Mr. Conklin during my first class, and while waiting for another session to begin, I was bolstered by the thought that I'd soon be on my way to Eagle Springs for the 4th of July weekend. While I was marking some composition papers, Walter Denton returned from the errand I'd sent him on.
Excuse me, Miss Brooks, but I'm back.
Did you get me a ticket to Eagle Springs, Walter?
Sure, Miss Brooks, but first I told Mr. Boynton I was going to the railroad station on an errand, and then I volunteered to pick up his ticket to Eagle Springs for him, and when he gave me the money, I just added what you'd given me and bought two tickets, seats 208 and 209 in the parlor car, right smack up against each other.
Why, Walter Denton, where did you ever get such a diabolical scheme?
From you. Now, don't you remember, Miss Brooks? You laid the whole thing out for me.
Never mind, Walter. Are you sure the seats are together?
Positive. And it was a lucky break I got any seats at all. The trains are sure crowded for this 4th of July weekend. Gosh, the station was alive with travelers.
Those are the best kind. Now, look, Walter. You have got to promise me you won't mention my trip to a soul. I don't want Mr. Boynton to know I'm going to Eagle Springs until he sits down next to me on that train.
You have my word as a gentleman and a scholar.
I've just read your composition. Your word as a gentleman will do.
No, all kidding aside, Miss Brooks, how did you like my composition? Great baseball yarn, isn't it?
Frankly, Walter, it's a little hard for me to judge. I know how crazy you are about baseball. I'd like to be fair in marking your composition, but, well, this time you've really got me stumped.
Why?
Maybe it's because the first six pages contain nothing but the American League box scores.
I just put that in to make it more dramatic.
Well, some of it is pretty exciting at that. I remember one very eloquent phrase that keeps recurring in the story. Had me right on the edge of my seat. Let me find it. Oh, here it is. Coleman to Sternweiss to Phillips.
That's a famous double play combination. You know, on the Yankees.
Oh, Yankees, of course. The northern team. Now, you'd better be getting getting on to your next class.
Now, okay, Miss Brooks. Oh, before I go, is there anything I can do for you while you're out of town?
Yes, Walter. Come to think of it, there is something you can do. You'll probably be seeing a lot of Harriet Conklin over the weekend, won't you?
That's for sure.
Well, you can do me this one big favor. Whenever Mr. Conklin's in the vicinity, please don't mention my name.
When Mr. Conklin's in the vicinity, I'm usually not. He hates me, you know.
You're not the only one. But just don't talk about me when he's around. I'm hoping he'll cool down a bit while I'm away. Oh, there's that pesky fly again. He's been in here all morning.
I'll be darned if I'd hang around summer school all day if I was a fly.
Maybe he needs the credits. Hand me that fly swatter, Walter. Thanks.
Oh, he lit over here on the door, Miss Brooks. I'll open it and let him fly out.
No, don't, Walter. He looks like a germ carrier. I think I've got a good bead on the little pest. Here goes.
Fortunately, I get my glasses wholesale.
Mr. Conklin.
Now that you've warmed up, Miss Brooks, how about trying the umbrella?
It was an accident, Mr. Conklin. Miss Brooks didn't mean to hit you. She was after that other pest. I mean, the fly.
Well, if it isn't Walter Denton. I've hit the jackpot this time.
Oh, please, Mr. Conklin, if you'll just sit down a minute.
Yeah, Mr. Conklin, just have a seat. I'll gather your glasses for you.
Yes. Oh, Denton.
Yes, sir?
Get out!
Yes, sir! That is, yes, sir.
Miss Brooks. The reason I came in here was to inform you, as I have the other members of the faculty, that I'm going away for a while.
Away? For how long, Mr. Conklin?
Well, this morning I planned on staying away for just 3 days. But then, when you siphoned off one of my lapels, I decided to make it 4 or 5. And just now, when you flogged me with that fly swatter, I realized I'll need at least a week.
Mr. Conklin, I won't deny that a series of extremely unfortunate incidents have occurred.
How very broad-minded of you. Well, there won't be any more of them for me, at least not for the next week. I always thought I was a man of more than average courage, Miss Brooks, but I've discovered recently that I'm not.
Please, Mr. Conklin.
Oh, it's true. It's true. I am a coward, Miss Brooks. But be that as it may, I am determined to live long enough to be an old coward. Hence, I am about to flee the city.
But where are you going, Mr.
Conklin? I don't know yet. I've called the railroad station, but their trains are all jammed with 4th of July weekenders. However...
Yes, I know. It's very crowded on almost all the trains.
I haven't finished talking, Miss Brooks. I was about to say... However, I'm going to try the airport this afternoon. Maybe I can get a plane for somewhere. Oh, that's a very annoying fly.
Oh, I've got the swatter, Mr. Conklin. I'll get it this time. You just sit still.
No, I'll get out of this seat if you don't mind.
You got up, Mr. Conklin.
As I was saying, Miss Brooks, I'll go to the airport. If I can't get a plane from somewhere, I may fly somewhere without a plane!
And so, class, it only requires a little concentration to avoid embarrassing mistakes in conversation. We'll take up next the works of Lord Byron. That's all for now. Class dismissed, and have a nice weekend.
Oh, excuse me, Miss Brooks. Could I see you for a minute?
Why, Mr. Boynton, you may see me for longer than that. Come in, won't you?
I just wanted to say goodbye, Miss Brooks.
Oh? Going somewhere?
Yes. Walter Denton just got me a ticket on the 4:15 to Eagle Springs. I'm going to spend the 4th of July weekend up there.
How nice for you, Mr. Boynton. It should do you a world of good.
Yes, I really need the rest. I've been working pretty hard lately. Still, I want you to know I'll miss our regular Friday afternoon date, Miss Brooks.
I don't see why. That was a pretty tiresome crowd we were running around with.
Miss Brooks, we went to the zoo on Fridays.
That's what I mean. Every week, the same old hairy faces.
Well, it does a man good to get away from town every so often. Gives him a chance to think things out. Commune with nature, as it were. You know, I like to get next to Mother Nature once in a while.
Now, isn't that funny? I feel the same way about Father Nature. That is, I'm sure you'll have a lovely time, Mr. Boynton.
I knew you'd understand, Miss Brooks. Walter got me a seat in the parlor car. They usually come in twos, you know.
Do they?
Yes, I hope someone nice sits next to me. It's quite a long trip, and a friendly traveling companion can make the time pass much more pleasantly.
I'm sure you'll draw the doll of the world.
No, not me. Just my luck. I'll probably wind up alongside some big fat dunce.
Do you know what? I mean, it's silly to even speculate about your train partner, Mr. Boynton. Forget it for now.
Well, if only he has a good sense of humor. I remember the last trip I took to New York. On my way back, I sat right next to George S. Kaufman, the famous playwright.
Really? How was his sense of humor?
You'd be surprised. It wasn't so good. I told him one of my best gags, too. You know the one where I make my shoes squeak on purpose? Well, when Kaufman asked me if they were new shoes, I said, "Shoes, nothing. Those are my Blue Jay corn plasters chirping." Now, you know that's funny.
It's a scream. How did Mr. Kaufman react?
He took two Alka-Seltzers and went to sleep.
Probably jealous because he didn't make it up.
Well, I guess I better be leaving now, Miss Brooks. I've still got to say goodbye to Mr. Conklin.
Well, whatever you do, don't mention my name to him. This is one of my bad days.
Miss Brooks, you shouldn't fight with Mr. Conklin.
I'm not fighting with him, Mr. Boynton. Why, Mr. Conklin would be the first to admit that we'd get along splendidly together if it weren't for just one thing.
What's that?
Me.
Come in.
I just dropped in to say goodbye, Mr. Conklin.
Oh, sit down a minute, Boynton. I'm just getting some information from the Travel Bureau. What did you say the name of that train was again? The Snake Eyes Limited? No, I'm afraid I don't care to go as far as Las Vegas. Goodbye. Now then, you were saying?
Just goodbye, Mr. Conklin. I'm going up to Eagle Springs for the weekend.
Eagle Springs? But you won't be able to get a train ticket. I've tried every which way to get out of this town, and it's just impossible.
Oh, not for me, it isn't. I've got my ticket right here, seat 209 in the parlor car on the 415.
Well, let's see that ticket, Boynton.
Well, I'll be running along now, if you don't mind.
Just a moment, Boynton. Boynton, I've always looked upon you as one of the outstanding members of Madison's faculty. Not just as a teacher, mind, although you're one of the best.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Conklin.
But also as a human being. You, Boynton, are the type of chap who would never let anyone down.
Oh, gosh, Mr. Conklin.
That's why I know you'll sell me that ticket and postpone your own vacation.
Postpone it? But, Mr. Conklin, I can't.
Can't? In the vocabulary of a Madison High School teacher, there is no such word as can't.
Well, then I won't. Oh, I'm sorry, sir, but I've worked very hard for this vacation
Of course you have, my boy. It was selfish of me to even suggest that you give me your ticket on the train. The fact that I'm on the verge of complete mental breakdown should not sway you in the slightest.
Mental breakdown? Well, I'm sorry to hear that, Mr. Conklin.
Oh, chin up, boy. Wipe that frown from your face. You should be smiling. You're going on a trip. A happy, carefree trip. Forget about me trembling in my stuffy little office. You're on the train, boy. I can see you now, sitting there in that plush parlor car, the sun streaming through the windows. What's this? Conductor is approaching. Tickets? Tickets, please. Where's your ticket?
Here it is.
Thanks, Boynton. I knew you'd come through.
Here you are, miss. Seat 208.
Thank you.
Now, this bag belongs to the gentleman in the next seat. He went back to the smoking car just before we pulled out.
Oh, that's perfect. Now I can really surprise him.
Oh, you know him?
Not as well as I'm going to. That is, we've never been on a vacation together before.
Oh, that's the fellow coming down the aisle there. Oh, yes. He's got adhesive tape on his glasses.
What? Are you sure that's the man who has seat 209?
I'm positive. I parked him here myself.
Oh, well, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to face the window before he sits down.
What for?
If he sees me before he sits down, he'll fall down.
Oh, I get it. It's a rib. Tickets.
205, 207. Ah, here we are, 209. Hi ho, to Eagle Springs we go. Well, I have a traveling companion. Yeah, I don't blame you for gazing out the window. Lovely scenery, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Nothing like taking a little trip, eh?
Mm-mm.
I don't mind telling you, I was a candidate for the Mayo Clinic before I got on this train. But it's going to be different now. Hi ho, to Eagle Springs we go. And as we go, I sing ho, ho, hi. Hey, look at the sun coming from behind that cloud. Shining on the window that way, it's beginning to reflect your features. Yes? Yes? There are your eyes. Nice eyes. There's your nose. Pretty nose. There's your mouth, your chin. Put them all together, and they add up.
Hi-ho, to the Mayo Clinic we go.
Eve Arden, as our Miss Brooks, returns in just a moment, but first...
Dream girl, beautiful luster cream girl.
Tonight... Yes, tonight, show him how much lovelier your hair can look after a Luster Cream shampoo. Luster Cream, world's finest shampoo. No other shampoo in the world gives you Kay Dumit's magic blend of secret ingredients plus gentle lanolin. Not a soap, not a liquid, Luster Cream shampoo leaves hair three ways lovelier. Fragrantly clean, free of loose dandruff, glistening with sheen, soft, manageable. Even in hardest water, Luster Cream lathers instantly. No special rinse needed after a Luster Cream shampoo. So gentle, Luster Cream is wonderful even for children's hair. Tonight, yes, tonight, try Luster Cream shampoo.
Dream girl, beautiful Luster Cream girl. You owe your crowning glory to a Luster Cream shampoo.
And now, once again, here is our Miss Brooks.
Well, after I found out the identity of Mr. Boynton's summer replacement on the train, I altered my plans for the weekend. Computing the wind velocity and the rate of speed at which we were traveling, I decided not to get off until the first stop. Then I took the next train back to town. And when I arrived at the depot, I ran right into Walter Denton.
Miss Brooks, what are you doing here? You should be halfway to Eagle Springs by now.
I was, Walter, but I found out that Mr. Boynton isn't going, and I couldn't bear the thought of letting him spend the weekend alone.
Alone? But Miss Brooks, Mr. Boynton got a last-minute cancellation and left for Eagle Springs 5 minutes ago.
What?
Sure, I drove him down.
Oh, great. Well, there's only one way I can celebrate the holiday now. I'll make an anonymous call to Mr. Conklin on Monday.
An anonymous call?
Yes, Walter. That's the 4th of July, and I'm really going to shoot off my mouth.
Next week, tune into another Our Miss Brooks show brought to you by Palmolive Soap, Your Beauty Hope, and Luster Cream Shampoo for soft, glamorous, caressable hair. Our Miss Brooks, starring Eve Arden, is produced by Larry Burns, written and directed by Al Lewis, with music by Wilbur Hatch. Here's a money-saving offer, men. A giant tube and a large tube of Palmolive brushless shaving cream for 49 cents. Yes, a 70-cent value for only 49 cents. This offer is made solely to prove you, too, can get smoother, more comfortable shaves the Palmolive brushless way. Just follow directions on the tube and treat your face to wonderful shaves. Yes, for extra shaving comfort at extra low cost, don't miss this Palmolive brushless bargain. At drug and toilet goods counters, get both giant and large size Palmolive brushless. A 70-cent value for only 49 cents. Last year, forest fires laid waste 30 million acres of America's timberland. This year, only you can keep it from happening again.
So when you or your family are camping, motoring in, or even near a forest area, remember these four rules. 1, crush out, completely out, all cigarette, cigar, and pipe ashes. 2, break matches in two after using. 3, drown all campfires, then stir and drown again. 4, before going near timber, ask fire authorities where campfires or even smoking are permitted. Remember, another 30 million acres will burn this year unless you are careful. For mystery liberally sprinkled with laughs, listen to Mr. and Mrs. North, the exciting, fun-packed adventures of an amateur detective and his beautiful wife. Tune in Tuesday evening over most of these same stations. And be with us again at the same time next week for another comedy episode of Our Miss Brooks. Bob Lamond speaking. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
That's your old-time radio fix for this week. I hope you enjoyed yourselves. Be sure to subscribe to The Chronic Rift on iTunes or visit us frequently at chronicrift.com.
Hit it! What a voice. What a voice. Simply means ink. Good night, folks. Signing off.
The Declaration will be a triumph. I tell you, a triumph. If I was ever sure of anything, I'm sure of that. A triumph. And if it isn't, we've still got 4 days left to think of something else.